Now, the Baltimore Orioles Hot Stove Show. This is your home for Birds Baseball. WBAL News Radio 1090, FM 101.5, and the WBAL Radio app.
And welcome to it with pitchers and catchers reporting to Sarasota, Florida in about a month. This is the Orioles Hot Stove Show on WBAL News Radio, brought to you by NJM Insurance. No jingles or mascots, just great insurance. It is Brett Hollander, along with Geoff Arnold, a couple of Orioles broadcasters chopping things up here as we inch closer to spring training 2023 in Sarasota, Florida. And Geoff, coming up on tonight's show, we have Orioles relief pitcher Bryan Baker, the Bake Show, who ended the season so strong and now a lock to be in this Orioles bullpen. Also, Orioles assistant general manager Eve Rosenbaum to talk about the International Signing Day, which is coming up in a few days, and a lot of other Orioles news and notes.
Yeah, Brett, it ought to be a packed show today. It's going to be great to talk to Bryan Baker, who I think we can say coming into this year is one of the locks to be in the Orioles bullpen. It was the strength of the team last year, and you know that there are not a whole lot of spots up for grabs. But based on how Baker finished his last season, I think it's pretty safe to say that he's going to be on that opening day roster. And then for Eve, talking about what has been a pretty productive period for the Orioles over the last couple of years. Kobe Perez has led the effort on the international signing front. Some of those prospects that the Orioles have brought on board are starting to make their way stateside and hopefully up the Orioles minor league ladder. And who knows, maybe soon some of them will be playing for the team.
Yeah, also on the program tonight, the Orioles make a couple of big fan announcements this week. They announced their 2023 promotional schedule, which is just loaded. And then coming up actually in a few weeks, and Geoff, we're both involved in this, it's the Orioles Caravan, which is back. It's coming up on February 2nd through the 5th, and it will be going throughout the Baltimore Metro, even into Pennsylvania and the entire state of Maryland coming up for that. So that's really exciting. That should be really fun with a lot of players that will be around for that. But let's start with Bryan Baker, who's coming up as our guest next segment, and this Orioles bullpen, obviously a strength of the team. And what a luxury it will be for Brandon Hyde for the first time in his managerial tenure to know who his opening day closer will be. We thought it could be Jorge Lopez last year. It was, but that was not a sure thing in February. And now the Orioles can work backwards. They know who their ninth inning guy will be, and I think they have a pretty good one.
Oh, they certainly do. And Felix Bautista, who, by the way, is getting one of his own bobbleheads coming into this year's promotional schedule. I wonder if it's going to be of Bautista on top of a mountain or anything like that, because of his – I agree, it should be. And Ben McDonald should maybe get some credit for that one because he came up with the mountain. But, no, it's going to be great to have Felix Bautista back. I was looking at the bullpen breakdown earlier. Five starters, eight relievers, because you're capped at 13 pitchers on your roster. And when you consider it, Brett, I'd say seven out of the spots are spoken for. You know Bautista's going to close. You have Michael Givens, who has come back, Cionel Perez, Dylan Tate, we mentioned the Bake Show. And then you figure Austin Voth is going to be your long guy after he had a great time with the Orioles last year. So that's six. D.L. Hall, I would tend to think, is probably going to be in the bullpen rather than the rotation. So he's possibly a multi-inning reliever for there. That's seven. And then you've got Andrew Politi, who is the Rule 5 pick, who'd have to stay with you the entire year. And you can't forget about guys like Keegan Aiken, Joey Crable, maybe Mike Bauman because of how he pitched out of the pen last year. So it's going to be really tight in trying to figure it out. And then, of course, everything could get blown up if the Orioles, by either trade or free agency, acquire another starting pitcher.
Yeah, what a difference. I mean, you're telling me right now that you have seven of the eight spots accounted for in any major league bullpen. That's really good. I think the Michael Givens move, which we have not had a lot of time to discuss, is a very under-talked about move in the sense that you make a strength of your club stronger. And not only is Michael Givens someone you can slide into almost any role, he's been a part of playoff teams, he's pitched in the postseason, he brings you that veteran leadership, he knows this environment, he knows a lot of the personnel and front office when it comes to the Baltimore Orioles after being drafted by this team in 2009 in the second round originally as a shortstop. So he's someone who came of age in the organization. But the versatility of someone like Michael Givens, and we really don't know what kind of role of Voth or Hall will have. I think we can kind of imagine everything else. I could see D.L. Hall coming on in the fifth inning and going two. I could see him getting big outs in the seventh or eighth. And we saw him at Yankee Stadium last year close out a game on a night where Felix Bautista couldn't go. And boy, did he look the part in front of 48,000.
Oh, he certainly did. And I think that Hall is intriguing because at the start of the year, and this will be a different start to the season than last year was because you'll have the normal spring training, that Hall could be utilized in any number of roles. He could be the fireman or the janitor or whatever you want to call a guy who comes in a spot where you need to get a couple of outs, and he can do that. He could pitch multiple innings because we know he's going to be stretched out coming into this year because he might start, but I'd say guessing that he's going to be part of the bullpen. And so he's the most intriguing one to me. Politi, he looked really good, but it's going to be very hard to make this bullpen this year. But as we heard Brandon Hyde say last year, when you start to turn the corner and you become to be a really good team, it starts to mean very tough roster decisions have to be made. And let's face it, over the last couple of years, those haven't necessarily been the case. And I think it's kind of refreshing to know that even some good pitchers that the Orioles had last year in their bullpen could possibly be on the outside looking in coming into this year.
Yeah, I mean, if you were to ask anyone in the first half of last season, Joey Crable and Keegan Aiken wouldn't be locks. That says how far this Orioles pen has come. Also names like Nick Vespi. And then you know that you'll have to go to the well at some point for optionable pieces. This is an Orioles rotation that's still young. You know they're not going to take the governors off the Grayson Rodriguez's and Tyler Wells of the world. You're hoping for innings increases, but they're not going to jump from where they're at to 200-plus, even if the team is contending. They're going to be very careful, as every team would be. So you have Spencer Watkins, the Yuri Canoes of the world, and guys like that. And the Orioles yesterday, Jeff, make a move inside the division for a left-handed flamethrower.
Yeah, Darwinzon Hernandez, who we have seen a couple of times in the last few years, and his stuff is electric. And I get the sense that they feel that Hernandez could be this year's version of CNL Perez, a pitcher with electric stuff, poor command, who the team can hopefully turn around and realize their potential. We saw it with Perez last year. Maybe it can be Hernandez's turn this year. And as you mentioned, the fact that you got a long season and you have to move guys in and out of your bullpen, the nice thing about Hernandez is that he's got two options remaining. So you'd be able to send him up and down.
And that's what they're looking for. Every team is looking for optionable pieces. We'll talk to someone who is a lock for the Orioles bullpen on opening day in 2023, the big right-hander, Bryan Baker. We'll talk to Bryan Baker next on Hot Stove Baseball on a Thursday night on WBAL.
Keep it here during the offseason for the latest news and updates on Birds Baseball. This is the Orioles Hot Stove Show on WBAL News Radio 1090, FM 101.5, and the WBAL radio app.
The Birdland Caravan is back February 2nd through 5th. Birdland Caravan brings Orioles baseball to your hometown. Interact with the team through a variety of fan rallies, happy hours, autograph sessions, O's bowling, and O's Top Golf. Learn more at Orioles.com/caravan.
This is Orioles Hot Stove on WBAL, brought to you by NJM Insurance. No jingles or mascots, just great insurance. That's Jeff. I'm Brett, and we're joined now by Orioles right-hander Bryan Baker, who will be a part of that great caravan event coming up in just a few weeks as we get closer to pitchers and catchers and spring training and eventually opening day 2023. And Bryan, thank you so much for joining us.
Absolutely, man. Thanks for having me.
Well, we appreciate it. You had a great first full season in the big leagues. How much does that change things for you in the offseason to have that experience, to do it for a full year, and to be productive in that year?
It's been really nice, actually, kind of having something to build off of. And, you know, this offseason's definitely, it's been a little bit easier, you know, knowing what to expect, you know, going into this season. You know, other than not having a lockout, hopefully going into this one.
Bryan, we just mentioned the Burland Caravan. I know you're going to be part of it on February 5th at Top Golf. I think you and I were talking about how your some of your off-season plans at the very end of the year. And I think one of them, if I remember correctly, was to improve your golf game. Has it gotten any better since the end of the season?
You know, I think it has. You know, that's a loose, you know, loose term, you know, better. But, you know, we've been putting in a little bit of work. So I think I'm in a better spot than I was when I talked to you, for sure.
And I imagine you do not get any holiday cards for members of the Toronto Blue Jays that just went by.
I haven't checked my mail, but no, I don't think so.
You know, it's amazing because I think if anyone saw you walking around town or in any city the Orioles playing, they probably would not even know that you are this raw, emotional guy. You're just, you know, ordinary as can be, except for the fact you're 6'6 and a big dude, because you have glasses on, you mind your business, you're walking around. But then when you get on that bump, you're kind of a different person.
Yeah, I think that's pretty spot on, man. I guess there's a different guy that comes out when I step between the lines. But I usually try to keep it pretty low key off the field, and have a good time and work hard as well. But save a lot of my energy for the field for sure.
Bryan, the adrenaline piece, has that always how it's been for you? Was it going that way in high school and in the minors, like, or is this something that you get to the major leagues, there's obviously a lot more of the line, and so you get a little bit more amped up than you used to?
I think it's always been there to a degree. I think it's just a competitive nature, whether it's a game with a bunch of stuff on the line, or if it, Pictionary with my buddies, I'm pretty locked in if there's some competitive game going on. But I think it's been there to a degree. It comes out more in bigger situations, and as I've been playing baseball for this long, I think I've kind of switched from a starter to a reliever these past 3-4 years, and it's just that adrenaline piece just comes more into play when you're a reliever for sure. So you got a small chance, a little small little window of opportunity in the game as a reliever to come in and do your job. So whenever you come out there, you got to have that energy for sure.
Orioles right-hander Bryan Baker is with us here on the Hot Stove Show. Bryan, last 11 games of the season, you covered 12 plus innings, no runs, 13 strikeouts to just 3 walks. You earned a save in the final win of the year. Last 6 weeks of the season, spanning 22 games, a 1.82 ERA and a batting average against of 174. You were really solid all year, but obviously those last 6 weeks stand out. What changed, if anything?
I just got a little more comfortable towards the end there, and kind of found my groove, and really just working with everybody on the pitching side, and kind of coming up with the best way to attack hitters for me, and then building off of some of the stuff that happened earlier in the year that you can kind of learn from. So knowing what not to do in certain spots, but I think the changeup kind of came into play as well, where I just got more feel with that as the year went on. So I think it's just kind of an accumulation of a bunch of things that kind of contributed to that last little stretch there.
We're with Bryan Baker, Orioles relief pitcher. It'd be very hard, as Brett talked about that stretch that you had, especially in those final 11 games, to do that for an entire season. But as you come into spring training and you're somebody who you figure to be a lock for the bullpen this year and very different from last year, what's one thing that you want to do better, which you think can allow you to continue that consistency that you had at the very end of last season?
I want to be able to throw any pitch at any time for a strike. So really eliminating any inconsistency with falling behind in counts or having a higher pitch count or giving out a free base here or there. My main goal is really just to fill up the zone and go right at guys and make them beat me with my best stuff. So anything else, that's not taken care of by that itself is kind of out of my control. So really just making sure that I bring the game to the batter and, do what I can to get it over the plate.
Orioles right-hander Bryan Baker is with us. And Bryan, it's time now for Fun Five baseball questions. Are you ready?
Absolutely.
All right. Who was the most influential baseball person in your life?
Influential baseball person? Wow. I would say my grandfather.
What was your high school senior year ERA?
Oh, I just saw this recently. I think it was a 0.78.
Now, did you swing it too in high school? Because you're a big guy.
I got worse at hitting as my high school career went on. I couldn't hit a breaking ball to save my life, and then I kind of started focusing on pitching a little more. But I did swing it all 4 years of high school, but definitely the batting average and everything kind of plummeted as the years went on.
Favorite baseball movie?
I would say Bull Durham.
Favorite minor league city to play or visit?
Asheville, North Carolina.
What would your third grade teacher say about Bryan Baker?
Well-behaved, intelligent.
I like it. Those are two good things. Bryan Baker, we appreciate so much. You'll be in town in a few weeks for the Orioles Birdland Caravan. You'll be at Top Golf. You'll be at the Sheraton in Towson. A great chance to see and meet Orioles fans. And then before you know it, you'll be reporting to Sarasota. So we appreciate your time so much.
Absolutely, man. I'm looking forward to it all.
That's Orioles right-hander Bryan Baker, a big part of the Orioles bullpen in 22 and in the coming 23 season. Much more still to get to, including Orioles assistant general manager Eve Rosenbaum, as we continue on Hot Stove. Great stuff with Orioles right-hander Bryan Baker. I think he's got a big future, as we mentioned. What a close he had to the 2022 season, earning a save in the Orioles' last victory of the year, but 11 scoreless appearances to end the season. When we come back, though, on Hot Stove, we turn our attention to the front office and we talk to assistant general manager Eve Rosenbaum. That's coming up next as we continue on Hot Stove on WBAL.
Give the gift of opening day with a Birdland membership. Buy any Birdland membership now and receive priority access to opening day tickets versus the Yankees. Go to Orioles.com/memberships. Now, more of the Hot Stove Show on WBAL News Radio 1090 and FM 101.5.
Hey, O's fans, did you see every Birdland membership comes with an exclusive members-only Adley Rutschman celebration bobblehead? A variety of membership options are available, including the all-new Flex membership. Plus, each membership receives access to opening day. Learn more at Orioles.com/memberships.
That's Jeff. I'm Brett. This is the Orioles Hot Stove Show on WBAL, brought to you by NJM Insurance. No jingles or mascots, just great insurance. And we are joined now by Orioles assistant general manager Eve Rosenbaum. Eve, great to hear from you. How are you?
Hey, Brad. Hey, Jeff. Thanks for having me on. First, I got to say, it sounds like I need to sign up for a Birdland membership so I can get my bobblehead. So
there are
some
great things on the promotional schedule coming up for this year. And it's about that time. We were just talking about this. You're heading to Florida in a month. Pitchers and catchers right around the corner. So for you and the rest of the front office, where are you guys right now and how you turn your attention to spring training and beyond?
Yeah, so right now we are shoring up our 40-man roster. So, I think we're going to be digging into some free agents later in this conversation with you guys. The free agent market, did move pretty quickly, but there's still plenty out there. So we're still talking to free agents, talking to their agents, making presentations, maybe trying to find another pitcher or two to come help out our bullpen or our rotation. But as we get closer and closer, we're just starting to think, okay, are there more NRIs we want to sign to shore up any holes we might have or any injuries we might have or just some guys we want to give a shot to break camp with us. But then, yeah, we are starting to turn our attention to the nuts and bolts of spring training. So, okay, is everyone getting down there? Are guys healthy? When are we going to have meetings? When are the coaches reporting? So we're starting to think more about that.
Eve, as you look at the free agent market, and you kind of teased it with something we were going to talk about, I think you expect that coming out of a year where a collective bargaining agreement is reached, that there's going to be a flurry of activity. But based on how it has turned out into this robust market, how did that compare with what your initial thoughts were about what you figured the free agent market was going to be?
I think you're spot on that history does show the coming out of a new CBA that there does tend to be a flurry of activity for whatever reason. So that was spot on with what happened this year. I do think the amount of mega deals that were signed during the winter meetings and right around the winter meetings was more than I was expecting. It was super exciting to follow. Just what a great time for baseball to see all these great players being locked up long-term with teams. It was very exciting to see. It did catch me by surprise just by the volume of it. But I guess next time I'll be more prepared for how quickly it goes.
Eve Rosenbaum, Orioles assistant general manager, is with us on the Hot Stove Show on WBAL. Over the last few months, there's clearly a balancing act when you see the Orioles have so many prospects. Some have gotten to the big leagues. Some are knocking on the door. We know a lot of those names. And then filling that spot with a veteran because you think you have a chance to really be competitive in the here and now. But who knows? Maybe that prospect can make you more competitive in the here and now as well. We saw that with Adley immediately, and we saw that with Gunnar Henderson, among others. How does the front office try and balance those two things out, especially when you don't want to block a young player when you think they're so close?
Yeah, it's definitely a tricky situation to navigate, but it's a good problem to have because you want to have so many prospects coming up and bursting through AAA and forcing you to put them in the majors. Like, that's exactly what we're trying to do. And so, you know, knock on wood, we appear to have been successful with that so far. So we talk about it a lot. Where we ultimately land is that the season is long. Guys get tired. Guys get hurt. Guys go through slumps. Some will underperform. Some will overperform. And something that we've seen all throughout the history of baseball is that baseball is really hard. And particularly when guys are young and at the beginning of their careers, they don't always hit the ground running at 100%. You know, we saw that in some respects with Adley getting off to a little bit of a slow start. And you know, some people were like, oh no, did we call him up too soon? Do we need to send him back? You know, that's, I think I saw some fans having that reaction, but in the front office, we said, nope, you know, he's fine. He's ready. It just takes some guys a little bit of time to get settled. So we want to have all of our bases covered to make sure that if someone does go through a little bit of a skid, or if someone is a little bit hurt, or maybe we're switching someone's, you know, position around, because fortunately we have this abundance of infielders with Urias and Mateo and Gunner and Vavra and Mountcastle. So we're going to be shifting guys around in terms of which positions they're going to play. We want to make sure they have time to get used to that. And so sometimes it's good to have players, you know, work out some of those kinks of shifting positions in AAA. We just want to make sure we're totally covered. And luckily with position players, we have 13 spots, so we have an extra bench spot to have someone who we can sort of rotate through. So that's ultimately where we land, is that it's better to have too many good players than to be one short. And that's why we end up going out and signing some veterans to complement the younger prospects that we have. And of course, there's also the element of these veterans come in and they know what it's like to be a big league player, and having them in the clubhouse to sort of raise these younger guys, that's just an absolutely intangible benefit that we can't value. And we love having our veterans come in to help our younger guys out in that respect.
We're spending a little bit more time with Eve Rosenbaum, who's the Orioles' assistant general manager. We're going to hear from Bryan Baker in just a little bit. Eve, when it comes to the trade market and having so much talent in your system, it seems like the Orioles, if they were to do a trade, could pretty much do one with anybody. But what is the level of difficulty and the level of maybe angst of possibly parting with the wrong prospect that could eventually maybe come back and burn you?
Oh, yeah, sure. It's high. You know, it's high on our end that we'd be scared to trade someone who then goes and, you know, lights up the world with another team. But then at the same time, the trade partners who we're talking with, if we're going to trade them a prospect and coming back to us, you know, maybe we're going to get a more established major leaguer, that other team also is worried about the risk of that major leaguer becoming a really, really good player and the prospect they get back in return being a flop. So there's always this asymmetrical risk where each team feels like they're taking on the bigger risk. And that's one of the reasons why trades are harder to pull off than you might think. But I think at the end of the day, we just love our prospects and we want to have as many of them as possible to give us as many bites at the apple as possible of having, you know, a team of all stars, which is a lot of times why we, you see us not necessarily trading away our prospects. You know, maybe we do that at some point. We explore all options, but we ultimately just love our guys and we don't want to see them playing in a different uniform.
Eve, a month away from pitchers and catchers reporting, what's your biggest concern right now on the 26-man roster or 40-man roster or organization up and down? Because I know you have to fill a lot of minor league spots as well.
Yeah, I think we're in a pretty good spot with our 40-man roster. You know, we're able to get Givens to shore up our bullpen. He brings, you know, a veteran presence that's going to help. And as we saw last year, you know, toward the end of the season, relievers can get tired when it's a really long season and they've been pitching in incredibly high volumes. So that's helpful. The trade for McCann was great to get a really established backstop to work with Adley the way that Chirinos did last year. And McCann's got upside given his recent performance as well. You know, we were able to fill out our rotation with Gibson, and then Frazier brings us, you know, really good defense and that veteran presence in the infield as well. So I feel like we're in a pretty good spot. I'd love to get another starting pitcher, because the old adage is true that you can never have too much pitching. I mean, you saw the Houston Astros with too many starters. They had to move guys to the bullpen, and look, it helped them win the World Series. So I think getting another starting pitcher would be great if we're able to pull that off. Looking at the rest of our rosters, I talk with Matt and Kent about that pretty frequently, and then Chris Holt as well, who there's always a lot of focus on making sure we have enough pitching at AAA that we can cover our major league team if someone goes down or if we have a doubleheader. And so far, it seems like we're in a pretty good spot with some NRIs we have coming in, and then with some of our guys who were in, high A or double A last year, who are going to be moving up and filling out our AAA pen and AAA rotations. We feel like we're in a pretty good spot with that as well.
Eve, last one for me. The international signing period is fast approaching. We know there's going to be some announcements of players that the Orioles are going to bring into the organization. But what is your level of excitement over this year's group?
Yeah, I'm super excited. Kobe and his team, they work literally year-round. There's no holidays when it comes to international, because there's always something going on in Venezuela or Colombia or the Dominican. So they've got a good crop of players coming in. I think this is really only the second year since Kobe got here that we have a class where we were scouting and committing players at the same time as the other teams. Because a really good analogy for their national signing period is that it's like college signing day, which is there's one day for us, it's January 15th when everyone signs, but a lot of the commitments have already been made, which means a lot of scouting has already taken place. And so when Kobe first came in, I think, I started fall of 2019, he started fall of 2018. For the 2018, 2019, even 2020 periods, a lot of those players were already, locked up with other teams when Kobe got here. So last year and now this year is really when we're sort of hitting our stride and we're able to sign some of these, bigger players, which, you'll see on Sunday who those names are. So I'm pretty excited about this class, and just, props to Kobe and the whole international scouting team for the guys that are able to sign, and they're able to turn over rocks all over the world to sign players.
Orioles Assistant General Manager Eve Rosenbaum. Eve, we appreciate so much. Thank you, and we'll catch up soon.
Yeah, thanks for having me, guys. I'll see you down in Sarasota.
That's coming in fast. Much more still to come on Orioles Hot Stove here on WBAL.
Follow the Orioles on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube. Learn more at Orioles.com/connect. Now back to the Orioles Hot Stove Show on WBAL News Radio 1090, FM 101.5, and the WBAL radio app.
O's fans, the 2023 promo schedule dropped on Tuesday. Fan favorites are back, including the floppy hat and Birdland Hawaiian shirt. More bobbleheads than ever, highlighted by an Adley Rutschman bobblehead inspired by Captain America. Plus, the Orioles soccer jersey, caps, T-shirts, and more. Learn more at Orioles.com/promotions and be the first to select your games for a Birdland membership.
Yeah, what a schedule. It will be full of great giveaways. This is Orioles Hot Stove on WBAL, brought to you by NJM Insurance. No jingles or mascots, just great insurance. Red Hollander with Geoff Arnold. Here on this Hot Stove Show, we've already heard from Orioles right-hander Bryan Baker, and we just heard from Orioles assistant GM Eve Rosenbaum. It's been a busy week for the Orioles in the sense of announcing the Birdland Caravan, which is coming up in just a few weeks, February 2nd through the 5th, hitting just all across the metro area and beyond, with stops in York, PA, also on the Eastern Shore. So really exciting for people throughout Birdland to get really close to a lot of their favorites, Orioles, and really building the anticipation for spring training. And then also the 2023 promo schedule was announced, Geoff. And I think what stands out is just the sheer volume of bobbleheads, including, you mentioned it, the Adley Rutschman bobblehead, which will just get a lot of pub coming in, inspired by Captain America from Marvel, but also big Felix Bautista, Ryan Mountcastle, and Eddie Murray will have a bobblehead. So a lot of floppy hats and bobbleheads and T-shirts and all of our favorites, including your favorite, the Hawaiian shirt. But this is a jam-packed schedule.
It certainly is a jam-packed schedule. I am wondering, with the Felix Bautista bobblehead, is he going to be on top of a mountain? Is he going to be scaling a mountain? What exactly is Felix Bautista going to be doing in his bobblehead? Because when Ben McDonald came up with the nickname, the mountain, I thought it fit perfectly. So maybe that'll be incorporated in the Bautista bobblehead. I'm just spitballing here. I have no real idea. I like the Oriole Bird Nickelodeon bobblehead. I'm interested in that. And let's face it, Brett, when we think of ways to improve the decor of the Orioles broadcast booth, a good way to do it is through adding up the bobbleheads. And we should have quite a collection by the end of the year.
That is true. And now the difference is the Orioles have had some exciting young players these last few years, Geoff, and they've certainly been able to highlight the likes of Mountcastle and Mullins and Hayes. But now there's just a big core group that exists that if you are in the world of marketing promotions, you get really excited about having someone like Abby Rutschman and Gunnar Henderson and Ryan Mountcastle and Felix Bautista and Cedric Mullins, all of these players entering their prime seasons. And that's a really exciting thing for a sports organization across any sport and any team in any league. That's just exactly where any organization wants to be.
And they're fan-friendly. That's the other thing about it, is you can't take into account enough just how good of guys all of them are, that they interact so well with fans. I mean, I think you took a photo of it a few years ago, just how Ryan Mountcastle, after almost every game, is signing autographs for people, and so many of the other players do it as well. So fans that, if they go to Top Golf, if they do bowling or any of the other activities, they're going to have a good time, and there's some stops at some different breweries and things like that. So it's a really good time to connect with so many members of the organization that you root for, you cheer for, and you have a sense are going to be with this team for a while.
Yeah, just a bunch of people connected with the organization, including so many players, will be a part of the Birdland Caravan coming up February 2nd through the 5th, including Adley, Felix Bautista, Johnny Means coming into town, Grayson Rodriguez, Cedric Mullins, Dylan Tate, and many more. And as you said, there'll be something at Top Golf. There'll be something at different breweries. They're going to hit Bel Air, College Park, Frederick, Bowie, York, PA, Eastern Shore, Towson, Odenton, and many more sites. So we encourage everyone to go to Orioles.com/caravan for more on that. And as far as the promotional schedule, as you said before, Geoff, Orioles.com/promotions to get the very latest. And now the countdown is really on for pitchers and catchers. It's an interesting time of the offseason. That free agent market is pretty much dried up, where it's such a flurry before the new year. But now I think a lot of organizations see their roster, Geoff, and they look to fill it in other ways. And maybe that's creatively with trades. And we're starting to see some of that come into fruition.
Yeah, especially when a team like the Mets, for example, loses out on Carlos Correa. So they might be looking to bring somebody on base. Miguel Rojas leaves the Marlins, goes to the Dodgers, and Marlins and Orioles have been speculated as being trading partners because of what the Marlins have as far as pitching goes. So I don't think the team is done quite yet.
Yeah, I agree. And then also, when you get to spring training, you see what's there, you see who's healthy. There'll always be injuries, and then a lot of teams adjust from that point forward. Remember, it's a very long spring training this year. Pitchers and catchers for the Orioles are reporting on February 15th in Sarasota. So you have a good 7 weeks, basically, to opening day, a chance to tweak your roster along the way. We'll come back. We'll wrap things up next on Hot Stove Baseball on a Thursday night on WBAL. Well, that does it for our program this evening. Thank you so much for joining us. A huge shout out to none other than Big Al, Alec Hildebeidel, I at Top Television Hill, also Ryan Schell and Chris Colleheim for their great work. We're back next Thursday for another edition of Orioles Hot Stove. That's coming up on January 19th. Also, a big thank you to Bryan Baker and Eve Rosenbaum for joining us this evening. For Geoff Arnold, I'm Brett Hollander. So long, and thanks for being with us on Hot Stove Baseball on WBAL.